Thank you for speaking with me, Professor Sellers-García. Would you begin by talking a little bit about the document that first inspired your book, about the four women in Escuintla who were accused of witchcraft?
Yeah, thank you. I'd be happy to talk about this document. It's a really fascinating document. It's one of the first that I started working with as a graduate student at UC Berkeley. And at the beginning, it was just going to be the departure point for a seminar paper. And it was going to be a kind of exercise in reading these early documents. I wanted to learn about the world of the Inquisition through this one case. It was at the Bancroft Library, and it has a really good collection, a small but good collection of cases from the Inquisition and other materials relating to colonial Latin America. As I started reading this Inquisition case, it's from the early 18th century, and it has to do with four women of mixed race. They were called mulatas, so they're of mixed African and Spanish, perhaps also Indian background. And they were accused of practicing witchcraft in various forms. And I was really sort of drawn in the way I think most of us are drawn in by things that are witchy these days. I wanted to understand why these women were being accused, how it could be that in some cases they were accused by very close family members or friends. The grandson of one of them testified against one of the accused women. And I also just couldn't get my head around the crimes themselves. They had been accused of turning into turkeys. One of them is supposedly turned into a cow and hexed someone by standing in the middle of the road. And I just couldn't get my head around it. I was, how could these things have happened? I wanted to understand the logistics of these acts. And as I read further, I began to see that I was asking the wrong questions. You know, I didn't need to understand these events from a 21st century perspective, a sort of scientific rational perspective, but rather to accept that from the point of view of early 18th century Guatemalans, these things really could have happened. They would have manifested in ways that perhaps seemed surprising to us, but that they really could transpire. And instead, I became interested in other questions. The case proceedings begun locally in this town, as you mentioned, Escuintla, which is on the Pacific coast of Guatemala, stretched out over many, many years. And there was a kind of flurry of depositions taken at the beginning. Many people testified against these four women. And then there was this long lag for almost 9 years while the case was sent to the Inquisition Tribunal, the local center of the Inquisition in Mexico City. And when the tribunal finally responded, it was 9 years later with arrest warrants for the women. And all of the women had passed away. And so there was this tremendous delay, and I couldn't understand why it had happened. Was it because the Inquisition was inefficient? That wasn't really the case, as most people described it for the time. Was it because they simply didn't care about this particular case? What was going on? And then I realized that I didn't actually know how the paper in the case moved from one place to another. I didn't know how it was that the local priest who had taken these depositions sent them to Mexico City in the first place. And as I started trying to answer those questions, I found myself involved in other bigger questions, not just how does paper move across colonial Latin American space, but also how do people at either end of those paper trails understand the distance covered by the mail or correspondence. So I realized in this case in particular, if it could take 9 years to hear back from the tribunal in Mexico, Mexico City would seem very, very far away. Not the way that we conceive of the distance between Guatemala and Mexico, you know, a short plane flight, but rather almost an insurmountable distance from the point of view of this particular case. And that became the opening for me in considering not just the way paper moves in colonial Latin America, but the way the distance is conceived.
Can you discuss the connection that you draw between the pejorative notion of the periphery and the concept of distance?
So the studies of peripheries have now been around for a while. And the notion of peripheral places is something that was articulated in the last few decades, first by a sociologist and then later by people in all different disciplines who found the notion of peripheries useful to think with in order to understand economic relationships, political relationships, and other related spheres. And the point we're at now is one where people acknowledge the peripheries exist, but they want to talk about them in different ways. And what I found in reading the literature on Latin America, in which the word periphery cropped up often, was that in some ways, scholars find themselves in a sort of defensive posture about peripheries. Because on the one hand, if they're studying a place that's considered peripheral, they have to acknowledge that it's thought of as peripheral either by the contemporaries of the period they're studying or by scholars in the present. So they need to acknowledge that, but they also want to assert that the place that they're studying matters. And so it's sort of this difficult situation where you want to, on the one hand, say, okay, yes, it was marginal, if you will, but on the other hand, it's marginal in a way that I think deserves further scrutiny. So I found myself in the same position, studying a place, Guatemala, that at the time, while important in some ways economically to the Spanish Empire, was not the center of the Spanish Empire. And it was also not the center of Spanish Empire in terms of movement and the type of paperwork flow that I was considering in my own research. But I did think that Guatemala mattered. And so being in that same bind pushed me to think about the larger questions related to marginal status, why we think of things as marginal, why this defensive posture arises in scholarly circles. And what I realized is that instead of trying to attack head-on the question of Guatemala's peripheral place, I should instead take advantage of it. And it helped me to realize that the negative connotation to peripheral, which we use now, echoes very closely the way that people in the colonial period used the word distante, or distant. So when they spoke of a place as being distant from the capital, what they meant was marginal to the capital, just in the same way as we use peripheral or marginal today. And that moment of insight allowed me to see that distance is not neutral in the colonial period. You don't say that Madrid is distant from Guatemala. You say that Guatemala is distant from Madrid. And that relationship is one that really describes the entire landscape of the Spanish Empire in terms of importance of place, centrality, and also, crucially for me, the way places relate to one another along routes. So I do think that there's this kind of echo between peripheral for us and distant for the time period, but in addition to that, for me, it was really an entryway into considering the connotations of distant in this particular time and place.
Why is Guatemala in particular such a useful example in your discussion?
Part of it has to do with this peripheral place that we were talking about. I do think that it occupies a peripheral place in the Spanish Empire in the 18th century, which is largely where I focus. And because some scholars might disagree with me about that, I'll say that it is peripheral in particular in the way that it fits into the communications network. There aren't important ports for Guatemala in this period. One port is created later on, but it's never kind of a hub. And for colonial Latin America in this period, it's really the waterways that are important to connecting it with the rest of the empire. And so for Guatemala not to have an important port of this kind means it is isolated in the larger network. So there's that. But I also think of Guatemala as useful for the conversation we're having today among scholars about what matters in academia. And I didn't choose Guatemala for this reason, but I like working on Guatemala because of what it says about the way the politics of our field and the way in which there is, of course, in the U.S. Academy, a lean toward U.S. history, which makes a good deal of sense. And within the community of people who study Latin America, there's a lean toward the big places, you know, Mexico, Brazil, Argentina, which also makes sense. But I like posing the question as to why that is, and whether the big places, the populous places, the wealthy places are the ones that exclusively matter in historical studies. And for me, studying Guatemala and studying it precisely as a periphery says to studies of Spanish Empire, There are places outside of these large central nodes that also matter for the history of the colonial period, and they also matter in a way that is unique. That is, they can tell us something about knowledge building, about the history of empire, about the way that empires are built and function, that perhaps centers cannot. So that's part of what brings it all together for me.
How did exploring the transportation of documents to, from, and within Guatemala impact your understanding of the contemporaneous concept of distance?
So my understanding of the contemporaneous concept of distance came about as I started looking into this question of how documents travel. And as I mentioned to you, I began with this case on the coast of Escuintla, and I needed to answer the question for myself of how the documents in the case moved from one place to another. And in answering that question and figuring out how the paper moved, I began to understand that the paper moved in ways different from how it moves now and in ways that illuminated conceptions of distance. So I started seeing that there were three related stages to the movement of paper. The first is before the paper even moves, and it's in the creation of the document. The second is the actual travel of the document over space. And the last is where it's stored. And sometimes these get all jumbled up together. Part of this comes about in looking at how documents are created. And there I realized that I propose in the first part of my book that there's something that we should think of as composite documents in the colonial period, where documents are not penned by one person in one place at one time, but rather are created by several people in different places. So an official in Guatemala City will start writing a document, and on a certain date, he'll send it to a different office. Somebody there will add on to the bottom of the page and add a second page and send it somewhere else, and so on. And along that sort of cumulative creative journey, the paper will stop at certain places. It may rest in an archive while other information is sought to augment it. It may be worked on by several officials at once in one place. So there are temporal pauses as well that are part of the document's movement. And this was the real insight for me, to realize that distance and understanding distance through a document's movement was temporal as well as spatial. And what I found was that people in colonial Guatemala described distance temporally. When speaking of the common league or legua, they really meant the amount of distance covered by a mule in an hour rather than any particular number of miles. And understanding that for Guatemalans, distance was temporal really made me rethink the way they saw themselves in relation to distant places, because that distance then became not just a measure of miles, but a question of time as well.
And how does the movement of these documents relate to their archival storage over time?
So as I was saying, I really think that the archival storage is strangely part of their movement, because it's part of this three-step process, the creation, the movement, and the storage. It may help to understand it to say a little bit about the people who created documents, and those are escribanos. Probably the easiest translation would be scribe, but in colonial society, escribanos did much more than just pen documents. They were very crucial legal figures, and it's almost more like a secretary official, somebody who's tasked with the responsibility of taking down important things, like a notary, but in a wide variety of roles. So these escribanos were the ones who were creating a lot of this paperwork that I'm looking at in this study. And escribanos were also, in this period, the ones who kept archives. So partly it's their dual role that makes these pieces of the whole fit together. But it's also, as I was describing, the way that documents move in a way that requires these kinds of pauses in different places as they are amended and elaborated by different officials. And so I think of their storage as really one part of their created process. And there's some also interesting things about how documents are stored that reflects the way that they're transported. So, for example, the archives that these escribanos kept were almost always organized with indexes. And indexes were also the organizational tool used to keep track of document travel. So when correspondence was placed on a ship and sent overseas, there would be an index of the letters being sent to make sure that nothing was lost. And in the same way, when documents were registered in an archive, there was an index kept in order to make sure that none of the documents went astray or were lost overboard in the space of the archive. And so here, these pieces of how the temporal pauses fit into movement, this is part of the larger argument that I'm trying to make about knowledge building in the Spanish Empire. In its whole, what this book tries to say is that peripheral places matter to the way knowledge was created in the Spanish Empire. And hopefully, scholars will find that true for other places as well, that they'll think about the other regions that they work on, in the colonial period especially, and say, how did the peripheral places figure into the building of knowledge? What I find is in Guatemala, even though knowledge is very centralized, that is to say, it all converges in a single place or a few single places, it starts at the very, very edges. So the people who know about distances, the people who can describe local terrain are Indians and villagers, people who do not have their names in official paperwork. They give this information to people like escribanos or officials who compile reports, who send them in this composite way to other nodes. The documents accumulate knowledge along the way, and then they're stored in central storehouses like in Seville or in Guatemala City. And so the larger point here is that this document travel, creation to storage that I'm describing, is really the process of knowledge building. And much of what we know about the Spanish Empire is because of these processes. We understand the way that the Spanish Empire worked, or we don't understand it, as the case may be, because of what these people at the very edges did or did not contribute.